Hi, I'm Steve Sandra, the Managing Director and CTO at PicoTest. Today's video is about measuring capacitors and inductors, either for direct simulation in ADS or for creating accurate broadband spice models using a simulation optimizer. Power supply switching ripple and control loop phase margin are dominated by the output inductor and the bulk capacitors. Simple RLC capacitor and inductor models can result in a design with more capacitors than necessary, adding to the design cost, consuming valuable circuit board real estate, and degrading the control loop performance. Distributed decoupling capacitors reduce the high frequency inductance of the power planes, minimizing the voltage noise. The model shown here requires half as many decoupling capacitors as the RLC model to achieve the same inductance. Circuit simulation is the fastest route to an optimum cost-effective design, but accurate models are essential, and different models are required for SPICE and for EM simulators. In this video, you'll learn how to perform a modified two-port shunt-through measurement to obtain high-quality data, why we need different simulation models for SPICE and EM simulators, and how an optimizer can help create broadband SPICE models from the measurements. At the end of the video, you'll be able to download my simulator workspace so that you can apply these techniques to your own projects. Fortunately, a simple VNA measurement yields accurate results that can be used to create these simulation models. The two-port shunt-through method offers more than 100 dB dynamic range and can measure very low impedance values, making it the best choice for measuring power components. In contrast, the dynamic range of the one-port reflection measurement is only 66 dB and can't measure impedance below a few hundred milliohms at best. A coaxial transformer like the one shown here is required when measuring low impedance at low frequencies. The two-port shunt-through measurement range extends from below 1 milliohm to as high as 1,000 ohms. But for best fidelity, the maximum impedance should be limited to 225 ohms. But later, I'll show you how to overcome this limitation. There are four steps in the process, beginning with calibrating the two instrument ports. This generally includes a through calibration between the two ports for measurements below 50 MHz. Short, open, and load calibrations of each port, as well as a through calibration, are required for higher frequency measurements. The analyzer user manual provides specific calibration instructions. Next, the component is mounted either in a fixture or in a printed circuit board, as I'm showing here. Once the component is mounted, the measurement is performed. If your VNA can export to a Touchstone Z format, the file can be exported and used directly in any simulator that supports S parameters. Otherwise, the S parameter data will be used to create a broadband SPICE model. The measurement is made up of two parts, the physical component and the component mount. The resistance and inductance of the mount are due to the physical geometry of the component and the printed circuit board properties. The mount can be determined either by simulation or by measurement. In either case, the component pads are shorted. The mount has to be removed for printed circuit board simulation because the EM simulator will automatically account for it. And if we include it in the model also, then it would be included twice. While a single RLC ceramic capacitor model is low fidelity, two parallel RLC elements are generally sufficient for an accurate, high-quality ceramic capacitor model. Four anchor values obtained from the measurement align the low-frequency capacitance, high-frequency inductance, series resonant frequency, and series resonant ESR. The capacitor measurement is included in the display so that both the measurement and the model results can be overlaid. Two shaping values are then adjusted for a nearly perfect fit. Non-polymer bulk capacitors exhibit frequency-dependent resistance and capacitance, requiring a more sophisticated model. Again, anchor points extracted from the measurement provide a good starting point. The two-port S21 capacitor measurement is transformed to impedance, and an error term is defined as the difference between the simulation and the measurement results. An optimizer goal is set to minimize this error term. Six tuning factors are initially set to 1 and include both manual and optimizer tuning options. These should be hand-tuned to get a reasonable fit, and then the optimizer can quickly fine-tune them. Once the optimizer is completed, all of the model parameter values are listed, and both the measured and simulated capacitor impedance are displayed. This model is also a near-perfect match. The mount impedance is measured by shorting the capacitor pads on the printed circuit board mount. Remember that low impedance, low frequency measurements require the use of a coaxial transformer. When measuring low impedance at low frequency, keep the connections as short as possible, especially the connection to port 1. This mount is 486 microohms and 764 picohenries. The resistance is generally low enough to ignore, and the inductance can be subtracted from the measured ESL to obtain the model with the mount removed. The two-port shunt method is also ideal for measuring power inductors and ferrite beads, both of which can include low impedance and high dynamic range. And again, since the low impedance occurs at low frequency, a coaxial transformer is required. The coaxial transformer is placed on port 2, and all calibrations are performed with the transformer connected. And again, the connection to port 1 should be kept as short as possible. The impedance of this particular Wirth inductor ranges from 17 milliohms at DC to more than the 225 ohm maximum measurement limit. Inductors and ferrite beads routinely exceed this 225 ohm limit at high frequency. While the dynamic range of the measurement is limited by the instrument, the measurement range or window can be scaled. The 225 ohm maximum measurement limitation is due to decreasing sensitivity as S21 approaches 1. The S21 measurement includes port impedance in the denominator, noted here as Zref, and so increasing the port impedance of the instrument reduces S21, allowing higher impedance measurements to be performed. Adding a series resistor at each port increases the apparent port impedance, providing a method of scaling the measurement range. The scaled range is shown here for some common value series resistors. Adding 499 ohm series resistors scales the measurement range to 11 milliohms minimum and 2500 ohms maximum, which supports the measurement of this inductor. A 0.1 microfarad capacitor is also shown using the series resistors. The capacitor also exceeds the 225 ohm measurement limit, and the measurement fidelity is improved by the addition of the series resistors. The short open load calibration is still performed at the cables, and the through calibration is performed with the series resistors included, but the device being measured removed. The series resistor circuit board connectors add parasitic capacitance and inductance, degrading the high frequency accuracy. These parasitics are eliminated by including the series resistors on the component mounting circuit board along with the device under test, improving the high frequency accuracy. In this video, we showed how accurate capacitor data can minimize the number of capacitors required, saving cost and valuable printed circuit board area. We showed how to optimize measurement fidelity by adding series resistors at each port. And we showed how to create bulk and ceramic broadband spice models from the measured data. If you'd like to explore these examples or apply them to your own projects, you can download My Aes Workspace by clicking on the link in the text description associated with this video, or by typing in the URL shown on this slide.